Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Apologies have been received from Natalie Dawn, and I'm pleased to say Evelyn Tweed is here as her substitute. Our first item of business today is the decision to take item 3 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. We are agreed. Item 2 is on evidence session on the Scottish Government's benefit take-up strategy. Publication of this strategy is a requirement under the Social Security Scotland Act. The first strategy was published in October 2019, and this is the second strategy published on the 21st of October. The previous Social Security Committee did an inquiry into benefit take-up, publishing its report in March of last year, and I would like to welcome to the meeting Minister Ben McPherson, and joining the Minister in person we also have Dr Rory Sutherland, who's supporting access to Social Security team leader, and join us online we have Vanna Anastasiadou, Economic Advisor, and Kirsten Sweeney, Strategic Communications and Marketing Lead, Social Security Scotland. I did ask about pronunciation before the meeting started, and I still managed to trip up on that. Sorry, Vanna. I invite the Minister now to make an opening statement, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. And thanks for inviting me to give evidence today on our latest benefit take-up strategy, published and laid before Parliament on the 21st of October. This new strategy builds on the 2019 strategy and sets out the Scottish Government's approach to encouraging and supporting the take-up of Scottish benefits, as well as providing our best estimates of the take-up rate for the benefits which Social Security Scotland are currently delivering. Although publication of this strategy is a duty placed on Scottish ministers by the Social Security Scotland Act 2018, it is much more than this. Ensuring that all forms of assistance are available and accessible to those who need them, and that everyone is able to take up their entitlements regardless of personal circumstance, is a fundamental priority for the Scottish Government and something we're very enthusiastic about. It is important to note that reserved benefits, of course, also play an important role in maximising people's incomes in Scotland. And it is disappointing that the DWP still do not have any corresponding strategy for ensuring these are taken up. I genuinely hope this changes. At the heart of this refresh strategy is a recognition that benefit take-up is part of a bigger picture. It is one pillar of a holistic Scottish Government approach to maximising incomes, which itself underpins commitments related to tackling poverty and recovering from the economic impacts of the COVID-19 pandemic. The new strategy is built around 5 key principles, which have been developed through extensive stakeholder engagement and experience panel research. In delivering the initiatives and interventions set out in the strategy, we will 1. Prioritise person-centred approaches, 2. Communicate and engage effectively, 3. Bring services to people, 4. Encourage cross-system collaboration, and 5. Continuously learn and improve. Each of these 5 principles taken alone will be important, but bringing them together in the new strategy means they will work in combination, yielding far greater impact. This benefit take-up strategy takes a whole system approach and provides a framework within which we will continue to encourage and support people in Scotland to access the assistance they are due. And I'm now happy to take any questions the committee may have.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That is very helpful. In the first set of questions, I would like to call Jeremy Balfour, please.
Good morning, Minister, and good morning to your team. It's good to have you back again. I suppose just looking forward, this is a kind of more looking forward one. At page 48 of the report, we have a commitment to undertake a review of adult disability payment in the summer of 2023. And I'm just wondering whether that review will look at, has it been a safe and secure transition? Has it been done with dignity, fairness and respect? Or will it look at reviewing the descriptors of what ADP might look at in the future? So how wide of a view? And if I could ask you to maybe look into your crystal ball, depending on what these recommendations are, is it your thinking, and initial thinking, but these recommendations would be implemented by the Parliament if there was cross-party, you know, if there was agreement on it, but in this session, or is it something that you're looking for in the next parliamentary session?
So, slightly off topic, but I'm happy to answer as much as I can at this juncture and at this point. So, of course, the commitment to the review of EDP in 2023 was made by the previous Cabinet Secretary, Ms Somerville, and I would refer Jeremy Balfour to her comments at that time. What the review is going to include and how it's going to be undertaken is currently under active consideration by the Scottish Government, and we will be happy to and will, of course, update Parliament via the committee on that in due course. I can say that it's about, as has been stipulated by the previous Cabinet Secretary, it will be looking at how ADP has performed at that juncture, but also considering what changes could and the recommendations that we'll receive as part of that review evaluated as should take place. And then there's consideration that will have to be undertaken as to how that will be, what the relationship of that will be with passported benefits. So there will be discussion required with the UK government. And as I have alluded to previously, myself and UK Minister Chloe Smith have already corresponded somewhat on passported benefits and look forward to discussing that constructively in due course. And also there will have to be active consideration as to the conclusion of case transfer. And one of as the member will know, one of the points that we have to consider as a government as we are undertaking both the two pieces of work of starting and opening for application new benefits and also undertaking case transfer, when those two aspects of work are working in tandem, we at the moment have to consider the eligibility criteria to be corresponding for both so that there's equity in that regard, and also also because of considerations around passporting. So I'm afraid that's all I can say at this juncture on the ADP review, but it's always been our intention, and I'm happy to confirm and emphasise that today to update the committee in due course on the review.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That's very helpful. Before bringing any other colleagues in, if you're wanting to indicate that they wish to do so, I'll just bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy shortly. I wonder if the Minister could outline why the Scottish Government picked the five principles that underpin the policy. Is there any particular reason why those five particular principles were chosen?
Thanks, Convener. The five principles, as I alluded to in my opening remarks, have been developed through our extensive engagement with stakeholders and people with experience of the social security system. So they build on the themes of the previous take-up strategy, which were removing social barriers to access, addressing costly and complex access, and improving access to information. And also, the five principles have been considered and decided upon because of consultation with the stakeholder take-up reference group and the learning gained through the projects funded through the benefit take-up and income maximisation funds. So building on all of that experience and insight and feedback, we have decided on the five principles.
Thank you, Minister. And in terms of those consultations and feedback that you've had with stakeholders, how has COVID impacted on your ability to ensure that take-up of Scottish Social Security benefits has been strong?
Yeah, well, of course, COVID has impacted all of us, not just in terms of the economy and our everyday lives and, of course, the impact on the health service, but also, you know, even as MSPs, it's affected our ability to engage with constituents. So it's affected our approach to improving benefit take-up in ways of course, that's reasonable just to note that. But we also responded and adapted the ways in which we interact with clients and stakeholders, as you would expect. So we continue to gather insight to understand better how the pandemic is driving longer-term behaviour, and this may impact on the channels we use to promote benefits over the longer term. For example, we may use radio and TV more and print advertising less, for example, because people aren't necessarily picking up printed materials in the same way they may have in the same settings. And we will always be mindful that we are required to use a range of channels to be inclusive as possible. So it has had an effect, radio going off. Just let that silence first. If I may, convener. Yeah. Of course, it has had an impact, but throughout the period, Social Security Scotland has been active and proactive at promoting our benefits in the ways we can. And I'll let Kirsten come in on this in a moment to say elaborate that further from an agency perspective. But members will have seen, whether it's via social media or via the different mechanisms in which we have sought to promote benefit take-up, both through stakeholder engagement and in the media, there has been a proactive position throughout the pandemic. Kirsten, do you want to add anything further to that?
Yes, thank you, Minister. Good morning, committee members. Yes, throughout COVID, it did impact on our ability to reach audiences, including previously we would have used things like out-of-home advertising, so advertising at bus stops, but with people staying at home and also with the priority to push health messages, that was an option that was taken away from us. We also have found in the past intermediaries, so people in community groups and community halls were an excellent way in which to get the message out. However, through COVID, that did reduce. What I would say is we are starting to see that return. We provide materials to stakeholders on a regular basis, and they order from us literature, which we are starting to see come back as restrictions have eased. However, with the benefits that are live at the moment, with the parental audience in particular, we have always found that online channels have been highly effective. So to give an example, with Facebook advertising alone, we managed to drive 50,000 applications in the last financial year. So that was always our key channel for promoting the benefits we have at the moment. So that managed to continue quite effectively. On the intermediaries, another thing that's probably worth flagging is through COVID, we did make sure that the word of mouth that got out through support services was able to continue by providing stakeholders with as much information as we can to help them promote onward our benefits. So we moved our engagement with stakeholders to online. We had 36 events and we reached a total of 2,818 stakeholders through that. Our local delivery service also held 754 meetings with stakeholders to raise awareness of our benefits, and that was between the period of September 2020 to September 2021. And our resources over that time were accessed 2,500 times, and that's to enable people to print them off themselves. And we are aware that people were putting that in things like boxes, food parcels that were being delivered to people, so that information was still getting out. I hope that was helpful.
That's very helpful. Thank you, Kirsten. It's interesting the Facebook advertising driving such demand and perhaps runs counter to the current dichotomy around the use of social media, so that's very helpful to note. I'll bring Pam Duncan-Glancy in here, followed by Emma Roddick, please.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning, Minister, and your team. My question at this point was almost a kind of supplementary, I think, from my colleague Jeremy Balfour's question around the disability benefits and carers' benefits. And in the take-up strategy, it's noted that you've you've highlighted that it's difficult to identify these people and these individuals. I would ask, what engagement have you had with disabled people's organisations and carers organisations to help you do that? And also, what research are you undertaking in order to help identify who is eligible for disability benefits and carers benefits, since the previous committee recommended that research be done?
Thanks. I'm going to bring Ruairi in shortly, but I'll say just a bit in the first instance. So one of the challenges that we face collectively is that it's not possible to estimate fully 100% accurately take up of disability and carer benefits using existing household data. For example, the Family Resources Survey. But using existing survey data to calculate the eligible population for disability benefits would unfortunately result in an inaccurate estimate of take up. And this is due to a number of factors, with the survey not capturing certain aspects. For example, all needs and day-to-day limitations that are required in the assessment for eligibility and disability benefits. And there is an element of discretion in how the actual assessments for disability benefits are undertaken and benefit award decisions are made. And as a result, those determined to be eligible through the surveys may not match those determined to be eligible through the assessment. So there are these challenges with the data, and the disability is self-reported in the surveys, which means that there's no objective measure for the eligible population, which is, I appreciate, is why you're partly why you're asking the question. So as part of the engagement in order to make sure that we are doing what we can, I'll let Ruairi talk in a minute about the actual stakeholder engagement that's taken place, because officials have led on that. But of course, both reflecting back and looking forward, there are strong commitments within the strategy to make sure that we're doing what's required and what we can do to reach out to those hard to reach groups and those who are more vulnerable, to inform and, as I said, encourage and support as much as possible benefit team. Do you want to say a bit more about that,
sure.
Ruairi, please?
Morning. So I can speak to your first point about engagement with stakeholders. The Minister might want to bring in my colleague Vanna Anastasiadou on the analytical point secondly. In terms of stakeholder engagement, we have a number of, as members will know, a number of advisory groups and reference groups within the social security policy area who are regularly engaged on all matters actually relating to their particular kind of client base, I guess. More specifically, the benefit take-up stakeholder reference group is an avenue down which we have taken conversations about establishing the eligible population, although, as the Minister's pointed out, and as no doubt if the Minister brings Vanna in, she will say it's a very difficult population to estimate because of the sort of broadly subjective I guess the subjective elements of the disability assessment required to establish eligibility. So without putting everyone through that assessment process, it's almost impossible to establish robustly what the eligible population would be. But I'm sort of overstepping into the analytical territory, which I'm less familiar with. So.
Thanks, Julian. And but it's helpful to that you've set out the engagement with stakeholders, which of course is extremely important. I think just before I do bring Vanna in, if I may, convener, just to add that our strategy report, as I said, discussed the limitations associated with estimating eligibility for disability and carer benefits, but it has also identified steps we are taking to improve the data quality so that we can measure take-up of disability and carer benefits in a more accurate way going forward. And these steps include adding or amending questions to the existing household surveys as well as exploring the feasibility of using health record data if we can in due course. So there are proactive steps underway to try and improve the situation. And Vanna, if I may bring you in for any further comment you may wish to add.
Yes, Minister. I think the key point to reflect on is that to measure accurately the eligible population of for disability and care benefits, currently we don't have the necessary tools. So what we are focusing on, and this is a long-term project we have started some years ago and is ongoing, but what we're focusing on is to improve those tools to allow us to estimate accurately the eligible population for disability and care benefits. So if I could just expand a little bit more on what the Minister set out and what we have set out in the second strategy report. We have developed a comprehensive approach, and this is as a result of engagement with analysts, academics, but also our counterparts in other government departments like DWP. So gathering all this information and evidence, the approach we have come up with involves three distinct steps. So one step is to use individual level data from management information that is going to be collected and recorded by Social Security Scotland. This information will help us understand better the gaps between the disability benefits decision-making process and the current disability-related survey questions. Another step is to improve existing questions or adding new questions to the population surveys, again, to get us closer to identifying this the truly eligible population for disability and care benefits. And a final longer-term step is linking survey data and administrative data. Before data linkage can be put in place, we will seek to improve as much as possible the disability-related questions in existing surveys, as the Minister explained, but also explore the feasibility of using health record data. However, data linkage is the most robust long-term solution that would also resolve, to an extent at least, the issue we have with self-reporting nature of the surveys. I hope that provides a little more context in what approach, in the approach we're undertaking to get us to a place where we can report take-up of disability and care benefits with confidence. Thank you.
Thanks, Vanna.
Thank you very much, Ms. Anastasia. I do now bring in Emma Roddick, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. You've acknowledged in the strategy that stigma obviously plays quite a big part in low benefit take-up. What is the government doing to tackle that stigma?
So I think, first of all, just record that we had a good discussion on this in the debate last week, and I think Emma Roddick made some really important points in her contribution to that debate. And I think that we have a collective responsibility as a parliament and also more widely as a society to deal with this issue, which has through some avenues been created and encouraged wrongly, and through other avenues has been appeased. But rather than looking back, let's look forward collectively as to how we commit as a parliament as a whole, as I urged in the debate last week, to really reduce and in time remove any sense of stigma of claiming Social Security, because we have a Social Security system for a reason, which is to help and support when we agree as a society that that support should be there, and that can be in a number of ways, as we know. So I just want to make that general, more conceptual point in the first instance, because I think it's really important. I think we have an important responsibility and opportunity here in Scotland to change that, but it will take some time. The passing of the 2018 Act was part of that, but there's more work to do, and it's about a change of social attitudes and a change of culture, and every politician can be a leader in that, as can others, including the media. So there are obviously questions to ask that we have to consider as a government, which is how do we proactively do that? And we do that through our media output, but and our contributions in the chamber, but also through the general work of Social Security Scotland. So we've first of all worked hard to make sure that applying for benefits is as accessible and supportive as possible, starting from the position that access to social security is a fundamental human right, and it is a collective, a shared investment that we are making together as a society. And I would just take this opportunity to encourage people to take the time to check what they may be entitled to and to apply for the money that they are due. That is the fundamental message. Clients who have accessed a payment or and know someone else who may be eligible, we are, and do what we can to encourage them to pass the information on. If they have a good experience, we encourage and try to support them to tell others about it, as this may make the difference for others in terms of them applying, the other person applying or not. And like I said, parliamentary colleagues and others can share information on benefits, whether it's putting a poster up in an office or encouraging local community centres or other entities to display information, sharing posts on social media, which I know colleagues do regularly, which is extremely helpful. Kirsten talked about the success of the Facebook the Facebook initiatives that Social Security Scotland have undertaken and the wider social media that they undertake. So if we can all share that as widely as possible. And also, as I said, this is a collective responsibility, and I appeal to everyone who's commenting on these issues to speak positively about social security, whether that's politicians, the media, or other stakeholders and individuals, so that we can collectively move to fully to a culture where stigma around claiming benefits is reduced and then eradicated, and actually we create a society where we believe in people being able to access support and getting support when they need it, and that we make that investment collectively and do so with passion and positivity and commitment as a populace as a whole.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. Have you got another question? Sorry, Ms. Roddick.
You touched a little bit there on the role of the media in supplementing your efforts. What would you expect or want them to do to help you drive down stigma?
Well, first of all, I should say thank you to all the media all those in the media who do share information about Social Security Scotland. Rightly, the media is part of the role of the media is to hold people to account and to scrutinise and to report, and that's absolutely right, of course. But also, when there is a positive story to tell and there is information that's helpful to share, I would urge the media to do that. And I'm grateful to all the individuals and the media outlets who've done that so far, and thank them in advance for what they'll no doubt do in the future. I think as well, though, there is a point that we really need to get away from. We really need to end the time or end instances of the media, some aspects, and thankfully in the minority, using terms like benefit cheats and scroungers and phrases like that. They help no one, and we really need to not be in a position going forward where such phrases are printed in articles or otherwise, and instead get to a position where we scrutinise the system, but we want to build integrity in the system and in the idea of social security, and that's a collective responsibility, including the media and including all of us as politicians.
Thank you very much, Minister. I'd like to bring in Miles Briggs now, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and good morning to the panel. I wanted to ask a few questions with regards to take-up of low-income benefits. Specifically, looking at the strategy, it suggests, and I know these are estimated figures, but it suggests that around about 59% of the funeral support payment had been taken up. Now, I wondered what work had been undertaken to evaluate why that was the case. And for most people, given this is a very sector-specific discussion people will have when they're trying to arrange a funeral for a loved one, why that you think that's so low, and what more is being done with the sector, for example, to be able to promote that benefit within the services they're delivering? Because it seems quite an easy opportunity to have that conversation and raise that opportunity for access to that benefit.
I thank Mr. Briggs for his questions on this important issue, and through the course of the bill in 2017-18, this was an area that I was particularly interested in and engaged in through that process. So, touching on the question of what are the reasons for the relatively low take up of funeral support payment, and how are we working and seeking to address that? So, we know that not everyone who is eligible for funeral support payment will apply, as many people plan ahead and make provision to cover the cost of their own funeral. So that's a particular issue to note. And the relatively low take-up figures for funeral support payment can be explained to an extent by the fact that our methodology of estimating take-up is at an early stage. We're in the early stages of that. And there's some degree of uncertainty attached to the benefits take-up estimate. And I can bring Vanna in on that in due course if you have any follow-ups, Mr. Briggs. So, but all of that taken in context, I think it's important to emphasise that funeral support payment is working well. It's supported over 9,500 bereaved families since launching in September 2019. And this has provided over £17 million of support to those who need it most. We have made it easier to apply, and as a result, we have increased the number of successful applications, and we have approved 78% of applications compared to 68% of applications being authorised by the UK government between 2019-20. So there is a successful picture. You talked about engagement with the sector. Engagement with the sector was one of the early meetings that I took up as minister, we are well connected with the organisations that represent the sector, and have an open dialogue on their concerns and on how together that we promote the benefit and take up of it, and that was one of the points that we discussed in my meeting with them, and we are engaged collectively on how we improve that.
Thank you for that response. With that in mind, why has the government decided not to include targets for uptake within the strategy in terms of trying to drive forward uptake in all these new benefits? And what was the rationale behind that?
So, it's just give me 1 minute, please. So, first of all, of course, we're in a position where there aren't targets within the UK system, and I'm not stating that as a political point. I'm just stating it as a point of context. And setting targets to improve take up would require having established a take up baseline. And again, it's related to the data question and where we started off from. So we only published our initial estimates of take-up of the benefits currently administered by Social Security in this second take-up strategy. And this means that the estimates may change as we improve our methodology and our underlying data. And as a result, the baseline that we could use to inform the setting of targets is still in development. So that's the one of the key points. And any target set now would be entirely arbitrary. So we want to set targets that are based on a set of baseline data that is properly robust. However, even with a baseline well established in the future, setting different targets for different benefits would likely lead to a potentially unfair system where some benefits are deemed to merit higher take-up than others. So we would need to be careful and cognizant of that. And of course, the purpose of our take-up strategy is to ensure that clients are aware of their eligibility and to promote take-up and to make sure that people are encouraged and properly supported to access Scottish Social Security assistance. So the strategy is very proactive in how does it support and encourage and inform as much as possible. But at this juncture, because of where we are in the journey of Social Security Scotland's establishment and the development of benefits here in Scotland, setting targets wouldn't be appropriate at this juncture for the reasons I've set out. However, we will continue to look at that matter as we progress into future strategies.
And just finally, I wanted to ask, when we visited Social Security Scotland last Monday, part of the discussion which I know we had was around groups who maybe find it difficult to access forms, filling out forms, technology challenges as well. I just wondered, in terms of the group who are not applying, what work's been done to identify whether or not this is really the key behind people not wanting to fill out huge numbers of forms, or maybe language or reading barriers?
So that accessibility point is extremely important, and I'll bring Kirsten in a second just to talk about how the accessibility of Social Security Scotland's communications and application processes is fundamental to the design of the IT infrastructure, the design of the forms that are created, the language, and then also producing materials in a way that is inclusive as possible. So in different languages we're required, and also in Braille and all the different ways that we quite rightly are creating materials in order to make sure they're accessible. But also, one of the key factors in the creation of Social Security Scotland service, and this has been a theme that ran through the discussions through the creation of the bill and has rightly and strongly been part of how we've considered the application process for clients through the journey of the creation of different benefits and of the service, is that we want people to be able to access the service in the way that's right for them. So if that's online, then our online interface needs to be as accessible and clear and user-friendly as possible, and the IT teams at Social Security Scotland are very focused on that and are delivering that. But we also want people to be able to pick up the phone and speak to Social Security Scotland if that's their preferred method of application and communication, to be able to do it on a video call if that's their preferred interface to engage with the service, to be able to meet an advisor in person to help them through the form if that's their preferred way of accessing the service. And we're providing all of that, and that's why the local delivery teams are so important, which are about to be initiated countrywide, and of course have been in place in the three pilot areas through the pilot of CDP. And it is that extra contribution, that extra commitment, that extra resource to make sure that people can access both the service and the benefits in the way that's right for them that's at the heart of what we're providing, and I think is really important. And that's why I'm so enthusiastic and passionate about the fact that we're providing these local delivery teams, because I think they will make a difference for those who maybe aren't as confident online or as digitally literate or don't want to do the form themselves and need a bit of support on that. Kirsten, I don't know if you want to say anything further about that.
So a thing probably worth flagging is that every part of the development of this new service we're doing through with the people who will use it. So we do user testing of all the different elements, and included in the sampling of those people that we work with to develop that, we make sure protected characteristics are part of that process. So that's testing everything from how they interact with the application form online, if it was a paper version, how they would want to use the local delivery service. And as an example of an improvement that will be coming through as a result of the feedback from those users, is in the adult disability payment form, there will be photographs included along with the questions to help with interpretation and understanding of what that's asking people for, as an example of ways in which we're going to make that easier to access. The Minister had highlighted about some of the other improvements we're making in the communication side. So the first thing somebody needs to know is that the benefit exists. So we proactively produce materials in 11 community languages, including British Sign Language, and we make sure we disseminate that via the stakeholders that have the relationships with the people who require it in those formats to get the message out. And once people start interacting with the service, it's in excess of 100 languages are available for people to interact with us. And we also produce things in easy read formats for those who require it. The important aspect is what the Minister focused on, it is that inclusive communication and the choice in how people want to interact with us, be that online, phone, post or face-to-face with the 400, at least 400 local delivery colleagues who will be working across the country once all the benefits have been introduced and people have been transferred to the new system. And I guess another thing probably to flag is that the Scottish Government has made provision for advocacy support for those who may require that to enable them to access their entitlements.
I'll leave it there, Convener. If that's...
Thank you very much indeed. I'd like to bring in Faisal Chowdhury now, please.
Thank you, Convener. The question for the Minister is to ask whether there are any plans to make Scotland's baby box for more accommodating to parents with disabled babies, be that more items in the box for are provided to low-income families?
Thank Mr. Chowdhury for that question. It's not an area of responsibility for myself as Social Security Minister, but more for health ministers. But I think if we may convene, if we note that point, and perhaps yourself and the relevant minister could engage on that, because I wouldn't want to answer on behalf of another minister. I think it would be more appropriate.
Thank you, Minister. I'm more than happy for us to look at how we can take that forward with ministerial colleagues to make sure that point's answered. I think it's an interesting point for us to note and to pursue. Do you have a further question, Mr. Chowdhury? No, thank you very much indeed. Next question is from Marie McNair, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, again. It's good to see you. Unfortunately, access to many of the Scottish benefits is dependent on being in receipt of reserved benefit. How have the UK Government responded to requests for a more unified and strategic approach to maximising take-up? And if that response was disappointing, how do you intend to follow up?
Thanks for that important question. First of all, as I said at the beginning, it's unfortunate that DWP don't have a similar strategy themselves. And, I just say that respectfully, that I think it would be a welcome step forward in terms of social security as a whole and promoting the benefits of social security and changing the culture that I talked about earlier if DWP were to change their position and introduce a similar strategy. We would like to work more closely with the Secretary of State for Work and Pensions on this, for example, to encourage a more collaborative approach to supporting benefit take-up of all benefits. Unfortunately, we haven't seen appetite for that yet. There was a joint letter from the previous Cabinet Secretary for Social Security and Older People and our Welsh and Northern Irish counterparts urging the DWP to take a more strategic approach to increasing benefit take-up during the pandemic, so in 2020. That letter was unanswered. I appreciate it was a busy time for all, but I think it was a good suggestion from the devolved administrations to put that forward. I have, as you would expect, been building up my relationship with UK ministers and Chloe Smith, the new minister, and look forward to engaging further with her constructively on a number of matters. And certainly this is something that we may discuss in due course, but I think it would be a welcome step forward from UK government if they were to implement such strategy. And I think that perhaps we can provide evidence and example of the difference that it makes, not just in terms of practically engaging clients and helping with uptake, but also bringing us as a parliamentary group of members and also as a society together to promote social security and the benefits that it provides and the collective enrichment and improvement that it helps facilitate within our society.
Thank you. It's disappointing to hear, but hopefully we'll get some positive engagement soon. I welcome the efforts to get decisions right the first time. At the end of the day, there's cases where people who are claiming, are not happy with the final decision. What we're doing in the strategy to promote the right to request redeterminations and appeals?
So, throughout the process of application and throughout the process of communication with clients, they are advised of the step process and what is available to them in terms of being able to request a redetermination, what support will be available to them. And as we roll out the advocacy service, there will be that will be a key part of both its work, but also the wider work collectively to make sure that people are advised and aware of the advocacy service and utilise the advocacy service. So it's built into the communications throughout the process. It's part of the wider communications on the website and on the engagement that we have. And is something that, like junctures like today, that we as ministers are keen to emphasise that those steps are there for people if they feel that the wrong decision has been made. And that is very clearly put to them, both that they have the option to request a redetermination or appeal and also the support that will be available through that process.
Thanks, Minister. That's reassuring.
Thank you very much indeed. Just going back to your answer to Ms McNair's previous question, I'd be appreciated if you could share that letter with the committee, please, just for information, the letter that was sent on behalf of the devolved nations. That would be helpful, please.
Certainly, Convener. We'll pass it on to you.
Thank you very much indeed. Evelyn Tweed, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. It's good to see you again. I very much welcome the strategy. There's so many good things in this that I think will offer a lot of reassurance about how the Scottish Government is considering benefits as we move forward. What I'm interested in is the holistic approach that is talked about within the document and how the Government is talking about working with the public sector, the third sector. Can you tell us what the government's going to do to promote this sort of collaborative working and what that will provide in terms of benefits?
Sure. So I think it's such an important point that's been highlighted. I mean, I think, you know, we've all got our anecdotal experiences, but I think of the engagement that I've had as minister with individuals who benefited from the social security system, and a lot of people have heard about the support that's available to them when they're taking their child to school or visiting their GP or passing through their community centre. So the engagement with both statutory services and collaboration with statutory services and with the third sector is so important. And, you know, just to give them the right emphasis as well in an equal sense, the way the third sector and organisations operating in a variety of different fields supporting individuals, either with disabilities or in care or who are carers, the way that those third sector organisations disseminate our information through their networks is outstanding and makes an important, really important difference. And then also the way that they feed back to us on the experiences of those that they support is really helpful too. So All of these aspects make a difference, and that's why, you know, for example, the fact that we are funding welfare rights advisors in 150 GP surgeries in Scotland's most deprived areas, you know, that will make an important difference in terms of people learning about and accessing Scottish Social Security in the settings of other statutory services. So we have had a holistic approach both to Social Security and maximising incomes throughout the period that's passed. But at the heart of the new strategy is, of course, as Evelyn Tweed emphasised, the recognition that benefit take-up is part of a bigger picture in terms of how do we encourage income maximisation and also tackle poverty and recover from the pandemic. So, you know, as I said, you can see this cross-system collaboration in our approach to funding welfare and advice and health partnership workers, which launched in September. You know, that's funded across health communities and social security in the Scottish Government. So it's a cross-government initiative, as well as being engaged in different parts of society. And also, we do have officials that convene an income and maximisation and working group, which brings together officials from across the government to make sure that we have a coordinated and clear sense of the collective direction of travel, and the support that we provide is joined up as much as possible to wrap around people to make sure that it's person-centred as much as possible, and to also drive better outcomes for people fundamentally. So there's a lot of collaboration work that's already undertaken, and the benefit strategy is focused on how do we improve and build on that.
Thanks, Minister. That's very positive and good to hear that we're taking that holistic approach and we're looking big picture. I was interested in the advocacy service, and you did touch on it earlier. Can you tell us how that advocacy service is going to help us with the increasing take-up of benefits?
Yeah, so was grateful for the session that we had on the advocacy service just a few weeks ago, and since then, of course, the procurement process has moved into the final stages, and the service is in the process of being rolled out now. I appreciate that at that juncture I did commit to coming to speak to the committee again about the advocacy service in due course, as I'm sure that would be something that the committee would be interested in. I am set to meet with Voiceability, who are, as the committee knows, are the organisation that we have contracted with to deliver the service, and I will be meeting with them later this month and look forward to that. I don't know, Ruairi, you have led officially on a lot of this in terms of with Voiceability and in the process of the procurement. I don't know if there's anything further you want to add.
Yeah, so I mean, I think in terms of how the advocacy service will support benefit take-up in general, the opportunity for disabled people to engage the services of an advocate in interaction with the Social Security Agency is one which allows far greater access and far greater support for disabled people to have a say in the processes that affect them, and to interact in a much more fulsome and meaningful way with the Social Security Agency. So I think by its very existence, the advocacy service, which is funded by the Scottish Government but independent of both the Scottish Government and Social Security Scotland, will undoubtedly play a part in bringing disabled people into the social security system in ways which work for them, in ways which support them, and in ways which allow them to have as much of a play as much of a part in that process as anyone else.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sutherland. Does that cover your questions?
Yes, that's
thank
fine.
You. Thank you. I'd like to bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy now, please.
Thank you, Convener. I have a few questions on monitoring and targets. I've heard this morning and I've seen in the strategy that that we're not, or that the government are not necessarily able to identify all the people, and I heard your response earlier about disabled people and carers' benefits. But in order to monitor whether or not the take-up strategy is being successful, it's important that we understand who should be taking it up and what is success. So without targets and without being able to understand who we think should be taking up the benefits, how are we going to commit to that, or how are we going to deliver on that statutory responsibility to monitor the strategy?
So I think this is a really important area, but also a very challenging one for all of us. So our policy evaluation programme will set out client experiences of the factors that helped or hindered their applying for the benefit. So that will provide important context of the situation in which the strategy operates. So that feedback will be important. And we will be looking for testimony that services were well advertised, that information was clearly accessible, and that the application process was straightforward. So our policy evaluation programme will play a role in evaluating and monitoring to an extent in the way that Pam Duncan-Glancy rightly emphasises is important. In addition, Social Security Scotland's Client Insight Programme will report on whether clients have been adequately supported by knowledgeable and understanding staff through receiving a fair decision on their application. So we will receive that feedback at that point. And of course, we report information annually in our Charter Measurement Framework, which was published last week on the 3rd of November. So there are other processes to help make sure that we, and other bits of work rightly, that we do monitor and evaluate as much as we can where we're at as a service and what we've improved, what we need to improve further, and how do we make sure we're serving those in which who access the service in ways as effectively and as informatively as possible.
Thank you, Minister. I have a follow-up question, if that's okay. And I appreciate that. And I actually have little doubt that the engagement between the agency and individuals who are coming through the system sounds as if it will be positive, and certainly a bit different from what's gone before it. But it's the people who are not seeing and who are not claiming the benefits yet that concerns me. So, for example, in the Scottish Child Payment, we know that in order to meet our targets to reduce child poverty, we need to increase uptake at least to 83%, but it's currently sitting at 77% uptake. So I wonder what are the government's plans to improve on that so that we meet our child poverty targets, although members will know that purely the uptake at the rate it currently is at will mean we won't necessarily meet those targets, but still, how are we going to meet those or find those approximately 25% of people who are eligible? And how are we going to find the other people who have not come through the system yet? My colleague Miles Briggs mentioned earlier about only 59% of people have taken up funeral support payments. So again, it's what you described a moment ago was a series of engagements that you'll carry out with people who have been through the system. What are we going to do for the people who are not getting the benefits yet and not taking them up?
So, first of all, thanks, Pam Duncan-Glancy, for all that you do to promote and emphasise the Scottish Child Payment in your own work, because that's an example of how utilising your own initiative and coverage can help raise awareness and constituency work of the benefits that are available. So I would say that there are some initiatives on Scottish Child Payment which I think you'll be interested in, which I'll just state to you now. So we have commissioned Ipsos Mori to conduct research to inform an interim evaluation of the initial rollout of Scottish Child Payment for 0 to 5-year-olds. And as with evaluations on our other benefits, this will contribute to a wider report that combine commissioned research with what we know from official statistics and population surveys. And this is due for publication in the summer of 2022. So that work will help us in in the areas that you've rightly highlighted, Pam Duncan-Glancy. And we also recently published our evaluation strategy for the devolution of disability benefits, which has a range of thematic projects into 2025 designed to assess the safe and secure transition of benefits from the DWP. So that will also help in terms of initial experiences of the application and decision making approach, and particularly around supporting information in the application process, and will draw largely from child disability payments. So it's not related to Scottish Child Payment, but is a piece of research in the same thematic area that will help us in order to improve our insight and evidence. Again, on child disability benefit, the experience of families applying for child disability benefit and the impact that it's had on their families and the well-being will be a key aspect of this work. So, we'll be looking at that in the period ahead following full rollout later this month of child disability payment. So in terms of the question around the 77% with regard to Scottish Child Payment, I think it's important to just recognise that, first of all, that, of course, 108,000 children have benefited from Scottish Child Payment, so it has been a success for a lot of people, but the estimated reduction of 3 percentage points in... The point around the 77%, rather, it's important to point out that this is an initial estimate, and we expect it to increase when Scottish Child Payment reaches its steady state. And this occurs when growth in the number of benefit recipients flattens and the number of benefit recipients settles at its natural level. So we are expecting an increase in terms of the data. I don't know if... Vanna, if you want to say anything further on that, just on the 77% aspect only.
Perhaps just to add that the 3 percentage point reduction that was estimated when we were developing the policy for Scottish Child Payment was the modelling was undertaken back in 2019, and the reduction of 3 percentage point was forecasted for the year 23-24. So there are two points here to flag. One is that the 83% of take-up was an assumption necessary to enable us to estimate the potential impact on child poverty the Scottish Child Payment would have. Since the modelling was undertaken, a lot has changed in terms of the economic conditions, and other factors that play into the child poverty forecast. So I'm saying that to explain that the take-up of the payment is not the sole factor that will determine the child poverty reduction in 23-24. And another key point to flag is that, just to expand on what the Minister has already set out, that we don't think that we believe or expect the take-up of Scottish Child Payment to increase by 23-24, where the 3% reduction was estimated against, because the benefit will has a long way to go in reaching the steady state. And perhaps it's also worth flagging here that the Scottish Fiscal Commission had previously forecast that take-up of Scottish Child Payment in 23-24 would be at 80%.
Thank you very much indeed. Have you got any further questions?
Not really.
No. Jeremy Balfour, please.
Thank you. Can I just come back to a point raised by my colleague Miles Briggs in regard to the funeral support payment? I should probably declare I'm the convener of a cross-party group on funerals and bereavement. And certainly the initial conversations I had with funeral directors was they were very positive in regard to filling out the form, the process, it was working really well. which again surprises me at 59. Now, I may have missed this, Minister, but what are we going to do to get this 41% who haven't claimed it? Now, I appreciate some have organised their own funeral and thus won't fall into that, but I don't think it'll be that high a percentage. So I was just wondering, and I may have missed it if I didn't, and I apologise, what actually are we going to do? And I wonder, is there any geographical breakdown? So is it more likely that people are claiming in central Scotland compared to the Borders or Highlands? And I wondered if that data has been recorded by Social Security Scotland, and if so, could we see those kind of breakdown of figures?
Okay, if I may, Convener, I'd be happy to come back to Mr. Balfour on some of those points, but I'll just say in the first instance that as I said, there is engagement with the sector and continued correspondence with the sector on how collectively we work to raise awareness of the benefit and to make sure that those who are entitled and want to claim do claim it. The general marketing and awareness campaigns that Social Security Scotland undertake, of course, promote the benefit as one of our 11 benefits. So there is that wider work that takes place. But I would be happy to take that away as a follow-up point on some of the more detailed questions that Mr. Balfour asked and respond in writing you. In due course, if that's helpful.
Thank you, Minister. Emma Roddick, please.
Thank you. Yes, the Scottish Government has obviously expanded free school meals quite recently to blanket age groups, which is something that I'm very supportive of and many others are too. But given claiming free school meals is linked to other payments, including at the moment bridging payments for Scottish Child Payment, what is being done to communicate the benefits of applying for free school meals, even if your kid is already being fed?
So, first of all, this question relates to, of course, how do we... So effectively, the free school meals is a passported benefit of entitlement to both to different benefits, and of course we're in a hybrid system here. So I think what Roddick rightly emphasises the importance of how do we within school settings raise awareness of Scottish benefits, and as I emphasised earlier, there is already significant engagement with the education sector and local authorities on how do we promote Scottish benefits within schools. The challenge, of course, is that we cannot promote reserve benefits because that's for the DWP to undertake that. So as much as there is engagement with, for example, Citizens Advice Scotland and some of the work that they do, of course, Scottish Government liaises with them, but it is... just the reality that reserve benefits are not promoted in the same way that Scottish Government benefits are. But I think, given the interconnectedness of receipt of free school meals and the passporting of that, that being passported from claiming other benefits, I think this is emphasises the importance of continued engagement with the education sector to promote take-up of Scottish benefits by individuals who are interacting with the school. And certainly that's been successful so far, but there's more we can do and we will continue to do it.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. Next I have Marie McNair, please.
Thanks, Convener. The introduction of the child disability payment has been piloted in three council areas, you know, Dundee, Perth and Kinross and the Western Isles. What lessons can be learnt from the pilot and what number of claims are we talking about collectively from these areas, and what source of supportive evidence secured to assess these claims? I'm aware that you might not have this information to hand, and if you don't, that's okay, but could you forward on to me when you get it?
So in terms of the CDP pilot, what lessons have we learned in the period? There was some evaluation on this that we received recently, and I'm certainly happy to provide that to the committee, especially ahead of the national launch on the 22nd of November. I think members should bear in mind that some of the considerations we have to be aware of in terms of the fact that it was a pilot, and part of the process of a pilot is to refine and to learn. So one of the really positive outcomes, of course, was, for example, that 88% of people who applied did so digitally. So that showed that both the accessibility of and the quality of the interfacing of Social Security Scotland's IT, public-facing IT, was very successfully engaged with by those engaged in the pilot for CDP. And I think one of the, so there were a number of factors to consider that we have taken on board ahead of national launch, but one of them, for example, is that some people were applying for CDP that were already on the UK benefit, and of course they will be transferred in due course, so they will be part of case transfer and therefore weren't able to make an application. So there's just some information awareness raising that we need to do ahead of national launch, and that has been all factored in for considerations around the 22nd of November. Kirsten, I don't know if you want to touch on any more of that.
Minister, you took the words out of my mouth. I think a key lesson that we have had through the pilot is looking at the weighting of our messaging around making sure we're promoting this benefit to those who maybe come into eligibility or may have been eligible for the legacy DWP benefit and haven't applied, but also managing the expectations of those clients already in receipt of disability living allowance for children and reassuring them that they will transfer, they will not have to reapply, and to manage their expectations around when that will happen, so that they don't think this is an additional benefit to disability living allowance for children, and to encourage them to not end an existing award from the DWP to move to us, because that will happen naturally. So that's been a key message. The other kind of thing that we are amplifying a bit in some of our communications in advance is just making really clear the types of evidence that may be helpful for us to make a decision, so that we get as much of that on receipt of the initial applications possible to enable us to make the decision as quickly as possible and minimise any back and forth with the client, although that support is there should it be required, to make sure we get all the evidence we need to make a decision.
Thank you, Minister. Look forward to the other additional information, if you can pass it on. Under the old system, people were deterred from applying for the carer's allowance because the underlying entitlement rules meant that for some there was no financial gain. What we're doing to get the message out that that's changed is that a gain will come from the carer's allowance supplement?
Well, of course, the carer's allowance supplement was the first benefit that was introduced in 2018 following the passage of the Act. Certainly through the process of its introduction and the experience of the last years, and then particularly, of course, with the additional payment last year in June 2020 and the forthcoming additional payment in December this year, we have undertaken proactively through central communications in government and in the agency to promote that, but also particularly engagement with carers' organisations and encouraging them to both raise awareness of and encourage application to the relevant the benefit in order to receive the additional amounts within their networks. And that's an ongoing exercise that we undertake with relevant stakeholders and have been doing. And of course, the passage of the bill helped bring attention to that issue organically, just for the fact that it was the first bill that we passed, the first non-emergency bill that we passed in this parliamentary session. I think that, through that process, there was significant awareness raised, but that work continues.
Thanks for that, Minister. No further questions this evening.
Thanks very much, Ms McNair. Just before I bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy, I think it would just be useful to note for colleagues that whether we're in public or private, I intend to suspend at 11 o'clock. It's looking more likely that we're going to be in public so that we can observe a two-minute silence. So just for colleagues to be aware of that. Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener. The Scottish Welfare Fund take-up appears to be quite dependent on postcode, and in fact the variability in success rates of applications is significant across the country. In addition to that, we're seeing more and more repeated applications for the Scottish Welfare Fund, which suggests to me that people are living in crisis. What are the government doing to review the Scottish Welfare Fund to address the variability across locations and postcodes in Scotland, and also to ensure that people are accessing benefits that are on a more permanent basis to ensure that they've got the money they need to live on, rather than consistently going back to what is essentially a crisis fund?
So, thanks for that important question. So, first of all, Pam Duncan-Glancy will be aware that, of course, the Cabinet Secretary announced a significant new winter package of support, much of which is allocation to local authorities in order to help with regard to funding at a local level. The Scottish Welfare Fund members will be aware that we committed in our manifesto pre-election to a review of the Scottish Welfare Fund in this parliamentary term. That work is progressing significantly towards that review initiating. I'm happy to take that away as a point of clarity to give to the committee following. I just need to be clear as to where the process is in that regard, in terms of initiating the review and the formalities that have to be considered in that process. Along with further information for Mr. Balfour on engagement in terms of funeral benefits, and then although I've given Marie McNair significant information on the evaluation of the pilot of CDP, anything more that I can add to that, I'm happy to also update Pam Duncan-Glancy on a clear position on the review of the Scottish Welfare Fund.
Thank you. That would be really helpful. And specifically, if you could outline in that when the review intends to start and what it will consider.
I will do that to the extent of which we can within the considerations of the process and just the issues around procuring and initiating such a review that you have to consider. But yeah, certainly, okay. As much as we can, we will.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Faisal Chowdhury now, please.
Thank you, Convener. How do you plan to limit the negative aspect of automation? For example, the universal credit, there have been 5 weeks wait dealing with the DWP's system confusion cost, etc.
Well, of course, that's a reserved benefit, the universal credit. So we aren't able to affect the process of universal credit at all. That is something that Mr. Chowdhury and indeed, if the committee was inclined, we would have to take up with the UK government. And just incidentally, when I was on this committee, I raised the issue of the five-week wait with the Secretary of State at that point and pressed it as a point of concern. And it's very disappointing that it is still an issue that people are having to face and that politicians are having to query at this juncture, because it is not helpful for those accessing the system in any way. In terms of automation generally in our system, there are some considerations around automation that are important. So in the longer term, for example, for benefits such as Scottish Child Payment, there is an intention to automate it where both it's appropriate and feasible, but there is some context to that that's quite important, if I may set out, convener. First of all, analysis is underway within the Scottish Government regarding the feasibility of using Scottish Child Payment and its eligibility criteria for automating education benefits such as free school meals, related to what Emma Roddick asked about earlier. And this current position is that the eligibility criteria differs, and we're exploring options in terms of how to achieve full automation. So that work is progressing. But again, for context, I think it's important for the committee to consider that automation is not universally welcomed and does not solve all the issues around take-up. And we know this because, for example, stakeholders responding to the benefit take-up inquiry of the previous Social Security Committee highlighted the complexity here. For example, the Joseph Rowntree Foundation in their written evidence submission stated that human advisers with robust knowledge of the system can assess the nuances of individual cases to identify eligibility in a way that automation likely never could. And also the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations in their written evidence made the point that algorithms do not lend themselves to nuanced decisions based on dignity, fairness and respect. So, you know, as we continue to evolve and improve the digital capacity of Social Security Scotland and the Scottish Government and the Scottish public sector more widely, including local government. And of course, the Scottish Government's digital strategy is a joint one with local government, which I think is quite significant. We will continue to consider how automation can be of assistance. But I think in terms of how we design the service for Social Security, we always need to also keep in mind that having advisors and having accessibility of being able to speak to someone, as I talked about earlier, is really important in the process, both in terms of application and resolution of any issues. So it's about how do we strike that balance. And just in conclusion, in terms of universal credit, I would encourage Mr. Treasury to take his point up with UK ministers.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed, Minister. Bring in Marie McNair again, please.
Thank you, Minister. Just on to theme six. There's a good example from Glasgow that means that registered births are then assisted to make Best Start grant claims. Are there any other examples of good practice elsewhere?
Sorry, if you could just elaborate on that example, because I'm not familiar with it.
Yeah. So obviously it's to do with you registered births in Glasgow. They help assist for you to make claims for the Best Start grant claim. So I'm just asking if there's any other examples of good practice elsewhere that you know of. Again, if you don't have it to hand, if you could.
Yeah, well, I think those examples exist across the country, and thanks for highlighting that particular one. And I spoke earlier about how, in my anecdotal experience, both as a constituency MSP and in the engagement that I've had as a minister with stakeholders and individual claimants, is that, you know, those life events are really important for signposting. So, for example, when families register a birth, as you've alluded to, or if an individual starts nursery or school, and that's particularly relevant to promoting the five family benefits that we have. So those are very important. So, for example, Social Security Scotland committed in our corporate plan to provide a joined-up service to clients. And this means providing them with the best advice possible and referring them to organisations who can help them if they further need it. So that's the overarching position within Social Security Scotland's operation. And through that, it's working closely with partners to support the development of referral pathways like those that Marie McNair's brought to light in terms of that particular example, to ensure that clients who need broader support can connect with an organisation who can provide that support. So this is a complex area of work in terms of how do we continue to make sure that at those signposting events that referral is happening and that engagement and information is happening. But we're certainly starting from a strong position, and particularly with regard to the five family benefits.
Thank you. It was good practice. I was just interested about other areas. The strategy aspires to a position where people are automatically referred to Social Security Scotland when things happen to them, and it makes them eligible for the benefit. How achievable is that aspiration, and how do we embed that in our approach to the public sector and other services that people access?
So, I mean, I think that gets to the overarching position of the strategy of how do we both promote and engage individuals in the wider support that's available to them. And you know, as one of the challenges going forward and as a government, and one of the strong focuses of one of the areas where the government is strongly focused as we recover from the pandemic, is how do we provide that wraparound support? And of course, Social Security Scotland is a very important part of that. And our benefit take-up strategy we're looking at today emphasises and considers the ways in which we will do that in terms of encouraging take-up of benefits, informing individuals about what's available and providing them with the support that they need to access them. But I think Marie McNair's question is more widely applicable to service delivery in the round, and I would refer her to the COVID recovery strategy that the Deputy First Minister published just a number of weeks ago, in which it's the clear focus of the government around how do we make sure that people are we take a person-centred approach, and that people are at the heart of what we're doing collectively in terms of public service provision is taken forward. And I think absolutely Social Security Scotland is a key part of that, but one of a variety of public services that need to be there and also collaborate and work together to support individuals.
Thanks, Minister.
Thank you very much. Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you, Convener. I'm not sure if you'll have time to answer this before we suspend the committee, but I wanted to ask, specifically with regards to strengthening portfolio working across government, Faisal Chowdhury touched upon this with regards to the baby box, because I think one of the key things is where people find out this information. And we know that 66% of parents welcomed the fact that there was information around breastfeeding and postnatal depression. So I just wondered, as Marie McNair touched upon earlier, whether or not that was being looked at to see whether or not that life event could include advertising for different benefits, the five family benefits you specifically mentioned.
Yeah, I'll bring Kirsten in terms of actually communication materials and when they're supplied to people, and perhaps after we suspend, because I'm just conscious of time, Convener. But I would say that I think that Mr. Briggs makes an important point around how do we provide that wraparound support for individuals collectively as government. And as I say, that is a key point of consideration for the government as a whole in terms of COVID recovery and where we move forward as a society more broadly from here. So I'll leave it there, Convener,
I'm happy for Kirsten to come in, and I'll cut off at about 10:59:40, if that's okay.
Sorry, I thought we were finishing at 10:58. Apologies.
So be as quick as I possibly can, Mr. Briggs. We do include information in the baby box about the five family payments. We are in the middle of running an evaluation of the effectiveness of the five family payments campaign, and the literature in the baby box came as one of the top channels that people said that they heard about these benefits as a result of. So that is a new way to promote benefits that was introduced at the start of this year, and it's showing to be effective. We also include materials in midwife and health visitor packs as well that are given to expectant and new mothers. And it's part of the conversations that midwives will have at key stages with mothers. So I hope that answers the question, but it is a tactic we're using and appears to be one that's working.
Thank you very much indeed, Kirsten. I think just to make sure that I'm not having to cut anybody off from either a question or an answer, given the time that we are. I'd like to suspend at this stage so that we can observe as a committee and with everybody in the room and virtually observe an act of remembrance and to have a 2 minutes silence. So we will be back at 11:02. Thank you very much. Thank you very much indeed, colleagues. Miles Briggs again, please.
Thank you, Convener. And then further to the question, it was with regards to the recent SCoS report on adult disability payments, which recommended a focus on active referrals being the way forward rather than just signposting. So I wondered, in terms of the strategy and going forward to develop pathways, whether or not that was going to be a key part of this to actively help refer people in, not just signpost them.
Sure. So, first of all, just put on record our gratitude for all the work that Scott's doing in evaluating regulations. So Mr Briggs will be aware that the SCoS report on the draft adult disability payment regulations was recently published, but we are still to formally respond to that. So we will touch on that recommendation in our formal response.
Thank you very much indeed. Jeremy Balfour, please.
Thank you. I mean, just following on a wee bit from theme one, but also this theme, the previous committee did a visit to Wester Hales in looking at this whole issue of uptake and going forward. And what came out very clearly was a lot of people won't even go to a school, won't go to the nearest GP to get this information. And in fact, one person said to us very clearly, unless you go door to door, you're going to miss a lot of people. Now, I appreciate that's not possible to go door to door, but it's how do we get the information down to those who, Pam Duncan Clancy talked about, who aren't already on these benefits? Because a lot of these individuals aren't on Facebook, certainly not on Twitter. And, you know, I'm just wondering what strategy do we have to reach the hardest individuals who would find it difficult to cross a road to get that information, let alone go to somewhere else, and particularly post-pandemic, where there's less access to GPs, we can't get into schools at the moment. How do we get that information out to people?
Sure. So I think that is one of the hardest questions for us collectively to answer, and I have considered this in two capacities now. First of all, when I was Minister for Europe, and I was considering how do we raise awareness of the UK government's EU settlement scheme to reach the hardest to reach, who might not necessarily access different services in the normal manner. Of course, there is the media work that Social Security Scotland does, so not just social media, but actually, you know, mainstream media, and I'll bring Kirsten in to say something about that in a moment. So work with newspapers, local radio, all the different mechanisms that you would expect. I do think, though, that the investment in the welfare advice and health partnerships is significant, because most individuals will access GP services and the NHS, the vast majority of people at some point. So the fact that we are providing that service so that we have 150 surgeries due to be delivering welfare advice services in-house is significant, and obviously we've funded that with new funding, so that's an important aspect of our outreach work. Kirsten, do you want to say a bit more about Social Security Scotland's activity in the mainstream media?
Yes, and sorry if it's okay as well, Minister, I may add something about our invite to apply that we use. But we work proactively with the mainstream media and also with community media outlets, also advertising at times in alternative languages where that is appropriate. A lot of this we try to do through case studies. A lot of people, if you see yourself, it'll make you more inclined to interact and it'll resonate and you'll realise it's for you. So that's why we rely quite heavily on case studies and some human interest stories with the media to try and raise awareness and visibility. But Mr. Balfour, I guess a key thing was, how do you, you know, arrive at somebody's door? And one of the key ways in which we do that is we use data provided by the DWP and HMRC to issue invites to those who, from that data, show may be eligible for a number of our family benefits. And this is something we'll be looking at across the benefits, if it's a tactic that we can deploy if the data is available to do so. We will be doing an evaluation of invite to apply and the impact of that later on in the year to understand, speak to some of those people who maybe did get an invite and then chose not to act on that, to better understand why and to see if there's anything we can do to improve that. And we are also undertaking some work at the moment to do research with some of the kind of more seldom heard groups to better understand the ways in which to disseminate information to them. At the moment, a lot of that does appear to be word of mouth, and we work closely with some stakeholders, including things like Gypsy Traveller groups, to utilise their existing channels and forums they have to get the message out. So, for example, there are online forums for Gypsy Traveller groups where we have provided information that Gypsy Travellers have made videos themselves talking to their own community about the benefits, as that is a trusted person that may be able to get that message out. So that's some of the examples of what we're doing at the moment to try and tackle that for the more seldom heard groups that are maybe not engaging at the moment with the benefit system. I would flag that some of the invite to apply, that the limitation with that is if they're not getting the qualifying benefit, you know, that therefore means that we are not able to reach them either. So that is a consideration for the DWP as well, and making sure people are getting their entitlements before we can then tap into making sure they access the benefits available via Social Security Scotland.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Sweeney. It's very insightful. Now I'd like to bring in, for the final set of questions, Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener. And thank you, Minister, and your team for the responses we've had today. They've been really helpful. The question I have is around automation and also the ability to flex that in the way that you described earlier for people who might need a human being to talk to them about the situation. There's a system that when people die, I'm sure the Minister will be aware, that's called Tell Us Once, where you tell the state once, literally, that someone has passed away, and that triggers a whole host of things, from stopping pensions to council tax to benefits and all the rest of it. And actually, that's quite helpful, because it lifts the burden of responsibility, as you'd understand at that time, is particularly difficult. Is this the sort of approach, or is this something that the government have considered for when people are not dying but in fact alive and looking for benefits, and that we could create a system where really we only have to kind of have that touch point once? And also, in terms of monitoring and monitoring uptake of benefits, and this is a slightly different question, but it's in the same theme. What are you doing to learn from monitoring of uptake of benefits through the minimum income guarantee work that you're doing as well?
Okay. So first, thanks for those questions. So first of all, with regard to one touch point or one interaction with a service, and then the individual being in a position where there's a proactive process around them, either digitally or otherwise, to engage them with other support. I mean, that does happen to a large extent already, but there's improvement to be undertaken. I mean, talking about the public service as a whole, but there is a refinement and an efficacy that can be brought to that to a greater extent, and government is very focused as a whole on that question, and I think, you know, that's something that we'll come back to as a collective, as a parliament, I'm sure, in the period ahead. And again, I would refer to the COVID recovery strategy and how that touches on some of these issues. I mean, another way of thinking about it as well is kind of no wrong door, is a phrase that I've used as well, which is, you know, if somebody goes to a GP practice that and asks about Social Security, then they're able to get some assistance. And that's exactly why we're providing these 150 advisors in GP practices to build on that concept and that capacity. And you know, I think this is about coordination between public services, but it's also about the development of our digital capacity of the public sector, and they're almost interrelated on how do we get that referral, you know, with proper and appropriate consideration around data protection and all the things that services rightly and of course have to consider. But how do we build that infrastructure, as well as that coordination, to provide the person with the most support that's available to them, so they're not having to go to different places, either physically or digitally, or otherwise. So we're starting from a good position on that, but there is more work to do across government and local government and stakeholders as a whole. And I think that's a really important thematic area of attention in the period ahead as we recover from the pandemic. Monitoring, you asked about in terms of going forward as well. I think it's, you know, I would refer to my comments earlier, because I think, you know, touched on the most important themes in that. But you know, we will continue to engage through the stakeholder take-up reference group and other entities that are already in place to make sure that we are monitoring the progress as much as we can within the data constraints that we've touched on earlier. Does that answer your point on evaluation?
Minimum income guarantee.
Apologies. Excuse me. I meant to touch on that as well. The work of the minimum income guarantee is being taken forward by the Cabinet Secretary, and of course it has a strong focus on income maximisation within that. And that work is at in terms of the formation of the group, and its evaluation is at an early stage. And I'll look forward to seeing its findings with regard to both helping us in the benefit take-up strategies implementation, but also in that evaluative process as well.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms. Stanisanu, Ms. Sweeney, Dr. Sutherland. Minister, thank you very much indeed for your time this morning, the extended time that you've given us. It's very much appreciated, very insightful and very helpful. And no doubt that we'll see you before us and we'll welcome you before us very soon once again. That concludes the public part of today's meeting. I will now suspend so we can move into private. Thank you.